Coach Freed.
Thank you all. I will say that my experience in hearing from so many of you and my own personal experience is that one of the privileges of a public health career is that you have to keep learning. Change is the norm, whether it's how you grow or how you transition into new roles, new topics. And if I tried to count, even in the role as dean over the years, how many new fields I've needed to learn to be able to see the big picture and put what I was doing in the context of how the world is changing, I don't even think I can count that high. So we want to, as you complete this survey, really see through your eyes about what would be valuable for your future learning and growth, and think together under Dean Joseph's leadership about how the school can contribute in a new ongoing way to our alumni, because you are not just our present, but the future. Thank you. And now for something completely different, but actually it totally builds on the conversations we've just been having. I am totally honored to introduce the moderator for our next panel. This panel will focus on public health leadership from leaders. What leadership looks like with a public health degree across sectors, how leadership lives inside oneself and how you enact it in your day-to-day life, and why public health leadership matters. And I'm thrilled to introduce the moderator for this panel, Margaret Crotty. Margaret, would you come up and take the lead here, as you often do? Margaret is president and CEO of JSI and board chair of Northwell Health. Prior to joining JSI, she was CEO of the Partnership with Children, a New York City-based provider of community health services and school-based mental health programs. And she earned her MPH from the Mailman School in 2016. Margaret, thank you for your leadership in so many dimensions and for today.
Should I call the panel up?
Yes, please.
Let me just say thank you, Dean Freed. This is such an honor to be here. And wait till you see this panel. I mean, I said to Katie on the way in, this is an extraordinary group of people. And she said, I know. And we've barely even scratched the surface of our alumni body. So I think we'll have three amazing leaders, but who represent so much of the hope and robust experience of this alumni group. So can I ask Ben, Brian, and Makini to come up? So it's so funny because we have four people whose last names start with C. So I have to think for 1 second before I do alphabetical order. I thought I would just say a couple of words and then ask each person to introduce themselves because they'll do it better. But what you'll see is not only a commitment to leadership, but a real commitment to equity in every single, really every step of each one of your careers. And we'll talk a little bit about that. And I thought what we could do is ask each person to talk about their career pathway, their pathway to leadership and what leadership means to them, to each of you. Dig into a couple of really cool things that each one of you is working on and the intersections. And then really talk a little bit more about healthcare leadership. And we'll have time at the end for questions. So Makini, we met in the bathroom this morning. We had had, and I was like, oh my gosh, I felt like I saw a movie star. And I was a little bit, what I said to her is like, you're just amazing. And she's like, I know, but I'm just sweaty coming from the subway. So it's such a pleasure. And I'll ask you to introduce yourself in a minute, but Makini has had, almost 20 years of emergency, being an emergency physician all over the world, and has really turned her attention to really systemic existential issues of health equity and what she calls the prescription for reparations. She's also done a lot of work on sex and labor trafficking. So I will let you do that. Ben Chu, who is one of the, like a national treasure, an unbelievable amount of leadership in some of the biggest health systems in the country, including our own health and hospitals here, and now is doing, just in the last couple of years, some board service, and so can really help us think through the different roles of leadership. And Brian, who runs the de Beaumont Foundation, also looking at health equity issues, and spent about many years in public health departments in Georgia, Texas, Philadelphia, but we'll ask him to talk a little bit about the de Beaumont Foundation as well. So I'm just going to go down the line because it's too confusing and with everybody having the same first letter. So Makini, let me ask you to talk about your career path.
Cool. Hi, good morning. Good morning. Yes. Hi, Dr. Chang. We worked together in the ED at Columbia, a block away. So yes, I am Makini Chisolm-Straker. I am a policy-based reparations specialist with a background in healthcare service delivery and public health. As Margaret said, I have worked all over the world as a researcher, as an administrator, and clinically. I should say that I've served and learned all over the world, including in Indian country, which I think people sometimes forget. These are sovereign nations on this part of Turtle Island. So have been really grateful to be able to do that. And in these settings, I've been serving in and learning in resource poor settings that are resource poor because of colonialism and conflict. And we'll talk a little bit more about it, but I think what's difficult maybe for the undiscerning eye to see is that I've held different titles and positions over the past couple decades. And they might seem unrelated, but to sort of paraphrase the flawed leader and the brilliance of Mahatma Gandhi, my commitment is not to consistency, it's to truth. And so the through line for me for all of that is truth and staying on my purpose. And if we get to talk further, hopefully people would see that, that my goal is not to follow a particular path, but to follow where truth leads me.
Okay. Truth, justice. I thought I'd just spend a little time telling you. People always ask me, how did I get to do the things I got to do? And I can't tell you there's a clear pathway, right, to that. So maybe I'll just tell you how I got to where I got to chronologically, right? So I was a chief resident in internal medicine at Kings County Hospital way back in the 80s. And we were sitting around trying to figure out what we're going to do with our careers. And, the other chief residents couldn't wait to get away from Kings County. They just thought that this was such a dysfunctional system. You know, the patients don't deserve the care that we give them, all that stuff that was going on. I just got so pissed off. I said, this is ridiculous. And I was going to become a cardiologist. But I just said, okay, I'm going to take a chance. And for a couple of years, I'll try to do something in this system. So I talked my chair of medicine to letting me, as a young chief resident, run the medical clinic, essentially, completely dysfunctional medical clinic. You had to be young and really stupid to take that on, but I did. And so that's how I started. I was able to recruit numbers of people to help me. We completely reconfigured how we did things. And I have to say that I learned a lot because 3 weeks before I started that job, I went down to the clinic and I did everyone else's job. I did the clerical works job, I did the nurse's job, I did pharmacy consultations, all of that stuff. And that was a valuable lesson because, you know, if you're in healthcare, you really have to listen to your patients and to your staff. And that's a key lesson in leadership. So as always in the public system, one thing leads to another. If you show a little bit of competence, they promote you, right? So I got promoted in 3 years to be chief of ambulatory care, at which point I realized there were a lot of things I didn't know. That's when I came to the Mailman. It was the School of Public Health at that time. Alan Rosenfield was here. And and by the way, the executive program didn't exist. So I had to do it a little bit at a time. Two courses. I think I had the record. It took me 3.5 years to get my MPH. I had two kids at the same time. Not me, my wife had two kids at the same time. And the A-Train was a great library. I lived in Brooklyn, so I studied on back and forth on the A-Train. And really what happened was I learned, I applied. It's sort of what you guys were talking about, learn and apply. So, you know, cancer epidemiology became a mammography screening program and colon cancer screening program where internists did the flex sigs, basically. That's what we did at Kings County. And then I took a course through, and so I learned healthcare economics. I learned about Medicaid, which is really important because, you know, you really have to understand where the finances come from. And then I took Larry Brown's still here, I know, but I took Larry Brown's politics and policy course, and it just opened my eyes. So I applied for a Robert Wood Johnson Health Policy Fellowship and went down to Washington, worked for Senator Bill Bradley, you know, in awe because, of course, a New York Knicks fan from way back. The only two Knicks championships were Bill Bradley teams, if you know that. Some of you may not know that. You know that, right? Of course. All the other years have been such heartbreak, right? But so I learned a lot about health policy, how things get done, and came back, became the medical director for the Health and Hospitals Corporation in a very dysfunctional administration, I have to say, which was good for me because, you know, if you're focused on policy, you're focused on doing the right thing, people come to you when there's a lot of dysfunction. So I got to know all of the deans of the medical schools who had come to me because they couldn't go to anybody else at that point. I don't want to be too political here, but when Mayor Giuliani got elected, I couldn't work for him. So I got recruited, believe it or not, both to NYU and then to Columbia as associate dean. So it was sort of my foray into academic medicine. And I learned a lot. I witnessed the Mount Sinai NYU merger and dismerger. And it was, you know, it was just really incredible watching all this stuff happening. When you do these things, you get to sit in the seats and watch all this stuff happen. And you learn about, well, what's going on here? Why did it work? Why didn't it work? What were the politics of it? Who were the major players? Who were the drivers, et cetera? So that's another piece of leadership, just really watching and learning by observing what happens in the world around you, right? So after that, believe it or not, I started writing position papers for Mark Green. I don't know if anybody remembers Mark Green, but he ran for mayor. And it turns out, to his great misfortune, that he ran for mayor and the primary day was 9/11. Right. And of course, primary day got canceled. He was shoo-in to get the nomination. And the 6 weeks intervening really took a hit on him. So he ended up winning the primary, but losing the mayoralty to Bloomberg. Right. I can go into why that happened, but I won't. You probably know. Right. You know. So I thought, OK, I'm at Columbia. I'm having a good time. But believe it or not, even though Mike Bloomberg knew that I wrote position papers for Mark Green, he ended up offering me the job of health and hospitals. So that's where I was for 3 years and really had a great time doing it. I mean, I won't go over all the things we did, but we ended up rebuilding a lot of the hospital system during that period of time. 3 years in, I got recruited, believe it or not, to Kaiser Permanente to run the Southern California region. And the reason I went was because, number one, it's Kaiser Permanente, but number two, it was a system built for performance. If you think about it, it's an integrated system, completely built for performance, health plan, and delivery system, and really a dedication to population health, right? For decades, it was 50 years of that. And the reason, so that's the reason I went. It was built for performance, but underperforming at the time. And so I spent 12 years there, you know, really did some, I felt like we did a lot of good things, and it became a system that was sort of good, but not great, to really one of the preeminent health systems in the country during that period of time. And so that's the career path that I had. There were other things I've done. And I'll talk a little bit more about boards in a little while, okay? But what I'd say is, if I looked at the lessons learned, it's about taking chances, right? Not being settled in your way. It's about focus on patient experience and quality. It always have being purpose-driven, and that'll really carry you a long way. I'd say you'd have to pay attention to your staff, listen to them, and also listen to your patients. We already talked about constant learning and trying new things. For me, it was being in the right place at the right time, and career paths sometimes depend on luck, right? And that's what happened.
Oh, good morning, everyone. I would like to tell you about my clinical practice, but I would get arrested because I don't have a license to practice medicine. So that's where I'm different from my colleagues here. I am not a clinical public health person. I am a good old governmental public health guy, and was very fortunate early in my career to go to an Emory Rollins School of Public Health seminar on gun violence. And it opened up like, wait, you can do policy and health simultaneously? And so instead of going to law school, where I would have made more money, I chose a whole career in public health. And as CEO of the Beaumont Foundation and many of my colleagues, you know, you get to a certain point in your career and you start to say, look, I made all the right choices to get to this role. I made none of the right choices to get to this role. I came to, I went to UNC to do a master's degree. I did that 1 year, and then I was like, I don't know that this is right for me, and I left. So I never finished that degree. Went to CDC, went to RWJ, then came to Mailman as in a PhD program. You might notice the PhD's not there on my name. So again, started that program, didn't finish that one. You know, bounced around health departments, always kind of being a change agent. You know, I don't think leadership comes to you when you get the title. The leadership comes to you from the staff. And there are amazing leaders at De Beaumont who are, you know, the most inexperienced to the most experienced. We all lead. You know, leadership is this idea that we can together achieve something greater than ourselves. And so I share all this, you know, I bounced around, I finally got a DRPH. And all of this is to say, like, you may not think you're on the right path right now. You may be thinking, you know, where do I go? The path will show itself over time. There is no perfect way, especially for those of us who are not clinical. And you kind of get an MPH, and when you leave public health school, it's kind of like you enter a Golden Corral buffet. They say you can do all of these things, and you're so overwhelmed by all the things you could do, you don't know which you should do. And so some of the just the leadership development, leadership practice that we have is just to make those chances, take those chances, engage with people, learn from people, and build your leadership, you know, utility belt. Like, be a leadership Batman. Have all those things that you've learned from people, you take from people, and give back to them in the same way. And so, you know, we have a huge challenge in public health. We are at a crossroads. We've come out of a pandemic weaker than we entered it. And so we have to right now help people understand what we are, who we are, what we deliver, and how we benefit this country. We are a 100-plus-year-old profession, and we still can't articulate our value proposition. There is more need right now in leadership and public health than we've ever had. And if we don't lead, we're going to be lost. And I think that's really critical in this time, especially.
Can you, well, first of all, I'd love to just talk about being a leadership Batman for a minute. But could you talk just a minute about the Beaumont Foundation? And one of the tools, I think, in that tool belt is how you look at data, and especially data justice, which I think is a pretty fascinating topic that you really show a lot of national leadership on.
Yeah, sure. The Beaumont Foundation is a private philanthropy. We were created by Pete de Beaumont, who founded Brookstone. And we have an endowment. We also raise funds. And we are people who are dedicated to the public health workforce, to public health policy, and to building partnerships that advance public health. And so one of our projects right now is data justice. We've probably heard a lot about data modernization. Well, data modernization is often framed as a tech problem. It's not a tech problem. It's a human problem, right? I Google shoes like 4 weeks ago, and I'm still getting ads for shoes. So clearly we have the technology. We put a robot on Mars, and then it sent pictures back, like when your grandpa went to the Grand Canyon. So we can do these things. Like we have the technology. The challenge is that we don't do it in the right way. We don't work with people. We think that epidemiology, and I am an epidemiologist, the data that we get are somehow pure and unbiased. That's where the biases are baked in. And biases baked into data are the most dangerous, because then they proliferate as you use those data. So we are working with the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation on a very cool project called Modernizing Anti-Racist Data Ecosystems for Health Justice, because we aren't talking to the people who the data are about. They don't get to shape the questions. And it you know, you have those moments throughout your career. When I worked in Philadelphia, we were working on a depression scale, and someone said, the question was, sometimes things get on top of me. And I talked to some clients when I was doing home visiting, and they're like, yeah, it happens all the time. I was like, well, tell me about that. Well, you know, my kid climbed on top of me the other day. A bug climbed on top of me. I was like, wait, that's not what that means. But of course it's not what that means, because no one talked to them, right? And I don't mean doing validity studies. I don't mean doing reliability studies. I mean really talking to people, putting the community at the table. And we did, and you know, while we advocate for data justice, sometimes we're culprits of not doing it. During the pandemic, all of our messaging, and just be real about this, all of the messaging that we came out with were typically from 1,000-person surveys of the general public. And so when we say things like Republicans think, well, which Republicans? In Massachusetts or Republicans in North Carolina? Because those are different people. Right? And we never got indigenous populations in any of that messaging. Never do our data reflect those folks. So how do we really, if we want to empower communities and we want to, you know, modernize our data ecosystems, it starts with the people who are going to be represented by those data. I am what I think is a really, really good epidemiologist. So I'm like the chocolate. And then the community, they have lived experience that I will never have. They're the peanut butter. If we can put it together, you get a Reese's, right? And unless you're allergic to peanuts, Reese's are really good, you know, better than a lump of peanut butter or a chocolate bar. So that's where we have to go. And this idea of data justice has to be more centered in the multitude of conversations about data modernization.
And I think that idea of data being driven by and perpetuating structural racism is really key to everything that we do, which is a clumsy segue that I'd love to ask you, Makini, to talk about your work and your prescription for reparations work that is very easy to follow online, and everybody should Google it.
Thank you. If you wanted to follow it online, you'd have to be on LinkedIn, I think. I'm not sure how LinkedIn really works, to be honest, but I think you have to be on it in order to subscribe to a newsletter, but you can do that if you Google my name and RX reparations. So like I said, I'm a policy-based reparations specialist that centers reparations for Black and Indigenous people living on what is now the United States. The way that I sort of, I guess, got there is, like I said, following the data, following the evidence. I don't use a smartphone, so it's the front, the back, and the battery. She's gonna be okay. So I think the best way that I can sort of frame it is that I came to the domestic policy space to do the work of public health. If we say that public health is about harm prevention, if it's about well-being maintenance, that's in our domestic policy. That doesn't happen in offices or clinics. It doesn't happen. The best thing I can do in the emergency department to prevent anything is to give someone their tetanus update. Like, vaccines are really the one thing that happen in healthcare settings that prevent something. Everything else is we're screening and we're mitigating fallout. And that's important, right? Like, you have to do it. But do we really want to say 7 generations from now that that's all we ever did? So domestic policy is public health. Public health is this big umbrella that I think is grossly underutilized. You can look at it from like a health equity, health disparities lens. I think that actually narrows things for us, because at the end of the day, I don't actually care about diabetes. I care about well-being and if people are happy and experience communal abundance and liberatory joy. I don't actually care about diabetes, right? Like, I care about it because it affects those things. Not having that, not experiencing those complications are a means to an end. They are not the end in and of themselves. So for me, that all lives in domestic policy. And when I look at what sort of the goals are that we've been talking about for decades, right? Accessible housing. I wouldn't even necessarily want to say affordable, because it, just like I have the right to breathe, I should have the right to be sheltered, regardless of whether I can pay for it. I should have the right to healthful food and green spaces and a living wage job, and also the ability to participate in the economy as a consumer if I don't have a job, because not everyone can work in a way that this country cares about. So thinking about all of those things, when you look at how policy is made in this country, as it has been even before it was the United States, when I look at those policies, it's very clear that until we have policy-based reparations, structural reparations, we're just really rehashing the same stuff. And I think in centering Black and Indigenous populations, number one, we're looking at two of the first groups to be systematically, historically, continuously oppressed by these policies, but also centering these groups would allow us to shift our goals and our values and our principles. And then we have the policies follow those goals, those values, those principles. The way that we sort of operate now is from this sort of scarcity mindset of there's not enough funding, there's not enough resources. We have enough. It's nonsense that we don't have enough. We absolutely have enough. It's a question of who is deciding, and are we willing to change those decision makers to reflect our values? What are our values? Have we collectively decided on that, 345 million of us? So when I think about that, the reason that it's important to, yes, we absolutely need financial reparations, but also think about restructuring our policies, is because people make policies. The idea that we're stuck with these policies is what keeps us stuck, unhappy, unfree, unwell. To shift that, we shift our values, we recognize what really matters to us, and then we build policies to meet our goals.
Could you just talk for a minute about the way you look at the definition of wealth and maybe define the racialized precarity that you write about?
Great, that's a great question. Wealth, so I think people sort of sometimes conflate income and wealth. I think if you're talking to a bunch of economists, they're totally on board already. But it's important to remember that an income is your paycheck, your day-to-day, this is, I'm paying these bills. Wealth is what you rely on in an emergency. It is what allows you to maintain your standard of living or at least survive that crisis. That crisis could be a climate crisis has impacted your home and you need to replace the roof, right? A crisis could also be you got COVID or the flu or any of hundreds of other viruses and need to miss work, and you need to stay housed. A lot of people in this room can do that, but a lot of people that I see in the emergency department can't. I could write them a doctor's note and it would mean nothing. They can't pay their bills with that. Their boss doesn't actually care. They will lose their job. It doesn't matter if it's legal, right? Because they're a dime a dozen and they're replaceable. Wealth is the ability to survive that. It's also the ability to propel yourself and your offspring forward, to send someone to an undergraduate university of any kind without going into debt, right? I mean, most people in this country actually can't do that. So when we think about wealth and why it matters, wealth is literally the predictor of whether you or not you will be well. If you don't have wealth, you are living in a systematically precarious state. The policies that we have enacted require that you have wealth to survive and to thrive. When we look at wealth in that way and understand its function, it becomes really important when we look at the Black-white wealth gap or the Native white wealth gap or the Asian American white wealth gap or any other wealth gap. And the reason that that matters is we live in a capitalist system, right? So you have to have wealth in order to survive. And so we have to shift our policies to, even if we didn't change our principles, if we were going to shift our policies to make it so that at the minimum people could survive, they could have the wealth to survive in this country. I would argue that we have to shift our principles too, though, and our values so that you don't need wealth to survive.
I hate to change the subject, but I do want to pivot a little bit back to the leadership discussion. But I think you can see why these three people are so sought after for the most prestigious fellowships, board seats, and every news and media outlet out there. but it occurs to me, you know, that really this could have been the last panel too, leadership and continuous learning. And that really is the nature, the way that each of you has spoken, the nature of public health. You try something, you test it, you scale it. If it works, if not, you ask more questions, and mostly you listen. And that really is sort of the definition of continuous learning. So I think we probably could have merged these panels even more. But let me just switch quickly to, and then I do want to have some time for questions. Ben, to talk a little bit about, you've had, you know, academic, private sector, government, you've run big systems. And now I also sit on a board, and I'd love to just have a quick conversation about board service. And you know, how important it is, how we can do it better, and what you're, how you value it.
You know, I think that board service is just another way of contributing, right, in a meaningful way. I've had a lot of board opportunities, but I started out because I was asked to be on a board as a result of the work I did at Kings County in the ambulatory care setting. I was asked to join the advisory board for the Robert Wood Johnson Local Initiatives Funding Partners. I don't think it exists anymore, but basically what they did was they tried to find novel programs and local funders to really institute novel ways of getting at better health care, right? And so I got the opportunity to go all over the country and learn about models of care anywhere from Utah, Alabama to Alaska. I got to go. So that's one thing that you should look for, opportunities to learn from serving on boards like that. Then I was on the now it's called the Charles B. Wang Health Center, but being part of a local community fairly qualified health center board is really an eye-opening experience. It just grounds you in what the community needs and how to deliver it, and not be so haughty in our ideas about how it should be done, but really figure out how to do it from the ground up. And then after being the chief medical officer, I served on the Fund for the City of New York board, which was unbelievable. They had unbelievable people on that board. Robert Caro, you know him. He was a board member with me at the time. So you get to learn from people with incredibly different, diverse perspectives and ideas of how to improve the well-being of New York City. That board was about. And then I just got professional boards. I've spent 6 years on the American Hospital Association board, chairing it 1 year. I'm currently chair of the National Committee of Quality Assurance, which is, for those of you who don't know, it certifies all of the health plans in the country and many of the provider systems as well. I've gotten to serve on the Joint Commission Board. What I would say about them is not that, you know, it's just to categorize the boards I've served on, but each and every one of them, you get to meet diverse sets of people and you learn from them, right? Because, you know, everyone has a different perspective. A well-crafted board has many different people with different perspectives, and they each teach you something. You may not agree with everything they say, but you learn from how they look at things and why it might be important. And if it's a large enough organization, like the American Hospital Association, I learned about rural hospitals, me from New York City, you know, rural hospitals are really important in this country, and they're really endangered in a lot of ways. And the solutions to rural hospitals is different than they are to SUNY hospitals or even Northwell, you know. But you know what I'm saying? So those are the kinds of things you learn if you stay open to the opportunities. And I think that if you go through your career, you'll get those opportunities at some point to embrace them, really. And I know sometimes it's hard, because it was hard for me to sit on a lot of boards and have full-time jobs, right? But it was always worth it. And in if you work for an organization that is at least progressive in the way they think about things and are interested in doing the right thing, they will support your time on the board, because they realize that you almost always get more than what you put into a board relationship.
I think a lot of the conversation has also touched on or directly talked about who sets the agenda, right? And there's an idea of a JSI. JSI is an international global health INGO. So we do big supply chain, health information, data transformation system work, a lot of maternal health and USAID kinds of things. And we talk all about shifting power. And it's really, really hard to do. And it's a lot of talk. And I wonder if, you know, you see opportunities from as serving on boards to help move that process of shifting power. Who's making the decisions? Who's driving the agenda? This is your work. But you know, how can we do that in these different leadership positions?
Well, it's not easy to do, as you say, right? And you can't really turn it on a dime, right? Policy is made in a very, very funny way, right? It takes a lot of time and effort, a lot of developing consensus in order to get movement, but it's definitely possible to do, right? I mean, you know, I think about numbers of the boards that I've been on, you know, changing the whole paradigm. I mean, at NCQA, one of the things we're trying to do is digital measurement, right, in a meaningful way, and that's not easy. It sounds like the technology is there, it should be able to do it easily, but it's not, believe me, it's not. But it's not about just the digital, changing the digital metrics. It's actually, how do you actually get people to use those metrics to get to better population health, greater equity? But I think that, you know, you can make progress. I mean, right now with NCQA, we have a health equity program that a lot of health systems are embracing. It's baby steps at this point, but at least they're getting people to measure it, right? I mean, and until you know what the gaps are, you just cannot solve the problem. You can pay lip service to it, but you and people are starting to measure this and seeing that there are real gaps and recognizing that in order to solve those gaps, you know, we have to change incentives in the payment system. We have to do other kinds of things in terms of structuring the delivery system. It can be done. It's just slow. You just have to be patient, right? And you also have to listen to other people.
I think there's a lot of intentionality to you and Brian and your work also. I think we could have many, many, many hours of conversation about data and data governance, but I want to give the chance to the audience to ask questions. Otherwise, I've got a bunch more. Anyone? Okay, then I'm going to launch into that conversation. It's about who owns the data. So we can see the gaps, who decides what we're going to measure, and then who owns that data.
No, I mean, I think that's critical. And the data should be owned by those who are reflected in it. But, you know, we've talked, and it's interesting, you know, I report to a board, and so it's interesting to kind of hear the board perspectives. And, you know, we're talking about leadership, and we've said, like, leadership positions and, you know, patience and listening, but there's a whole kind of spectrum of leadership. And we need those leaders who want to be patient. And we need those leaders who are sick of being patient. And we need folks to really drive change. And so I think it's important for all of us to understand the kind of leader we want to be, right? Knowing who you are and being authentically you. So, like, you know, I listen to, like, you're great, and the patience that you have and just the presence that you have. And I'm like, I'm not that. While you are working the supply chain, I'm lighting the Molotov cocktail. And, you know, I mean, just to have the courage to talk about reparations in America, that's a different kind of leadership. It there's bravery and there's courage at every, you know, level of leadership. And I think we just need to be very thoughtful about where we are on that spectrum. And it's going to take all of us to get the change that we want. But I think you were absolutely right. This is not a question about resources. It's a question about political will. I mean, my favorite thing is, well, what we need a research study to look at hunger. Really? You need an R01 to figure out if you're hungry, get some food? You know, we need a research study, a multinational research study on housing. Well, get them a house, get them a place to live. But we choose to go a different route and make it seem like this is not about political will. And again, I always go back to that Mars rover deal, right? Because we built a rocket and we built a robot and we put the robot in the rocket ship and we sent it to Mars. And then it took photos and it sent it home to us. I don't know how to build a rocket. I don't know how to build a robot. I don't know that Mars is real. Like, yeah. I assume so because they tell me, but I've not been there. What did it take to do that? What did it take to build that rocket? How much money, how much science, how much intelligence? And yet in this city, in every city, we have a bunch of kids who have asthma, who go to the ER, we send them home, they go to the pediatrician, and we can't align our data to even know that those kids live in the same apartment building. And it's not their physical limitation, it's the fact that we gotta change the HVAC in the apartment building. We need to get low interest loans on the street to actually go and get that property owner to change out that HVAC, and then we'll save healthcare costs. But we need, you know, my feeling sometimes with public health is we're really nice and we gotta get really pissed off. And I'm kind of, you know, we've been in a system for a long time. And so that's my leadership challenge to you, is how to figure out how pissed off you need to be so that you don't get excluded from the room, but that you are lighting those small fires.
Do you want to jump in? Oh, well, I actually will ask you to jump in because I think this other topic of, you know, the quote unquote social determinants of health, or as you say, social determinants of disease, are not random. Like, it's not, you know, they're deliberate, they're, you know, exact, the system is working exactly as planned.
What you just said.
Yeah. Think about this. You've written.
Period, full stop. Yeah, it is. I mean, there's not, I mean, I have a whole newsletter. I could say more. Yeah, it isn't, it is a trick, a lie that we were spending money to go to Mars. I mean, like I said, I don't have a smartphone. We went to the moon. We went to space before there were smartphones, y'all, before there were mobile phones for the commoner. Like, so it's not a question of, do we have the resources? It's will we allocate them, right? The federal government needs to support Ukraine and they don't raise our federal taxes. The Fed puts in some, like Congress authorizes the Fed to type in some numbers into a computer and then authorizes the funds, right? So the money is there. That's not the question at all. It's really a question, really, I think it actually does come down to leadership. Part of it is who are we choosing to be our leaders, but also what does it look like to lead? And I would say that when I look at the people that I respect and have been led by and want to be like, I won't name their names because I'm gonna leave someone out and then I'll get in trouble. But I will say the first people who led me were my parents, Tambra Chisholm and Howard Straker, and my grandmother, Yvonne Straker. And when I look at them, they're not people who want the spotlight. But if you give it to them, they have listened to themselves, their own experiences, and the experiences of the people around them, their community. And so when they have the spotlight, they're gonna use it to serve the community, the people that think like them, that don't think like them, because you know all of us deserve all the things. We're all worthy. And they understand that when you're leading, it's not about the title or the position. That is how we commonly think of leadership, right? And even undergirding that is the ability to influence people. But leadership, to my mind, is about a mission, a goal, a value. And influencing people is a byproduct of that. It's part of that process, but it's not the goal. The goal is actually the mission. What are you trying to accomplish? And building teams that you believe in, that you support, in any number of angles. If, you know, when the emergency department, maybe I'm not allowed to say this, but sometimes I do triage because we're short staffed. It takes me longer, right? But I can do the triage. I can figure out where someone belongs in the emergency department. So sometimes it means leading from behind or in the front or adjacent or just getting out of the way. That's leadership too, is just being like, oh, this isn't the mic. I shouldn't be holding the mic. I'm gonna get out of the way. Oh, the grant should go to these folks. I'm gonna get out of the way. Leading in a good way is, I think, difficult to do, but some of the things that I think would lead us to this place where we're actually using resources appropriately is to have leaders that are creative and strategic and logic-based, sounds basic, evidence-based. And by evidence, I don't just mean the research that we create to say that water makes things wet, but also lived experience and also history, because history is evidence. It literally happened. It's history, right? Like that is evidence, that is data, and we should be using it to build policy, not just, oh, we commissioned a study to find out that people were hungry and how to feed them. That, to me, that's leading in a good way.
You know, I think that it's important for us to light fires. I actually agree with you, Brian, but I don't think that it always works. I mean, you're right. Sometimes you piss people off and you're not in the room anymore. But, you know, there's something to be said for leadership that's much more incremental, because it's much more important to get things done than to lay a pathway that everybody says is should be the way to go. And that's not taking away from where we should be going, right? We should be really looking for a world that really thinks about equity and thinks about health for people and distributive wealth. But you know, if you're actually trying to solve problems, it's not easy to do it that way. You just can't do it that way. I'll just tell you one thing. I believe it or not, I used to run an emergency room at Kings County, and it was really during the worst time. It was the worst job I ever had, I have to tell you. You know, and I didn't do it because I was an ER doctor. I did it because, it was nobody else was there to do it, and things were so horrible at the Kings County emergency room that I took it on to do to really set in motion a better service that actually could support an ER residency training program to move on. But it was during the time of the crack epidemic. HIV AIDS was rampant. There was a emerging multi-drug resistant tuberculosis was rampant there, and homelessness was still a big problem. And You know, see, everybody was throwing up their hands, and also ER overcrowding. I mean, I had patients with TB in my emergency room for 3 days. I couldn't get them a bed. I mean, people used to hate me because they used to make ward rounds. And me, you can imagine me, I don't yell at anybody generally, but I was screaming at nurses that were hiding beds because it meant that somebody had to stay in the ER instead of getting a bed overnight, right? You know that. You know the drill. They don't want the admission to come up until the next shift comes up. So, but the way we solved that problem was really everybody coming together, recognizing there was an issue, and incrementally putting in the pieces to solve that problem. And it's, it really is was the only way to do it. Because sure, you could write a plan. But until you could get people to implement that plan, the prison system to implement it, the homeless services to really take care of people, you just couldn't get it done. You couldn't solve that problem. Directly observed therapy, right? It was an innovation that had to come on board before you could actually make those dents in it. So I would say that, sure, we should all keep the vision of where we think the society should be going. But in order to make a difference in many people's lives, we have to look locally and we have to look incrementally and actually revel in the progress that we make, to tell you the truth. So, I mean, I don't know whether that's helpful or not, but.
And you know, everybody in this room is a leader. All of us share the fact that we've been at the Mailman School of Public Health. Mailman doesn't turn out MPHs or DRPHs. Mailman turns out leaders. And so this is our responsibility. And each one of us are a leader. We have to live up to that mantle. And I would caution all of us, because I think about this a lot. I think one of the things that helped me along my way is when I became CEO, I just realized that that just meant 10 old dudes on my board wanted me to lead their shop. That's it. I didn't get superpowers that day. I didn't get a cape. I'm just the same dude I was before. And we have this like tau of leadership that we believe. So, you know, working in health departments, like, well, today we're naming so-and-so the new leader of the health department. What makes you the leader of the health department? You've actually never even seen a health department. You've never worked in a health department. But because the mayor likes you, you're the leader? No, you're just a dude the mayor liked. So don't buy into that, right? They're never going to write books about my mom, but my mom was a leader. Right? JFK made amazing speeches that he didn't write. Someone else wrote his speeches. He's just an actor, right? And didn't even get, those guys don't even get Emmys for writing who write those speeches. Be the leaders that you are, right? Don't buy into it. We just had the UN thing down, you know, for this week, and it's all the leaders. Why? Because you're the governor? You know, is Trump a leader because he was elected? Does that apply to him? Answer's no. So I want you all to come away from this embracing all that you bring as leaders and the change that you can make. You are privileged in that you had the opportunity to come to one of the best public health institutions in the world to learn. You have a responsibility. You owe a debt to society, and we together need to make sure that we're living up and paying that debt. And if there's ever a time where you're questioning where you are, what leadership you can be, you got to talk to each other. This is such an amazing network of people that we have to take advantage of. But if we all, in our differences, so, you know, you can do incremental, I can do light on fire, and we will both together make it work. And we're going to finally get people talking about policy. Because policy is a prescription for better health. Policy is medicine. And we don't hear that enough. And this is how we're going to change the country. But if we keep doing the same stuff we've always done, we're going to get the same outcomes. If you want to, you know, if you want to change the outcome of any game, you got to change the rules. And that takes leadership.
Okay, I think we just have time for a question or two.
Yeah.
Oh,
no,
I should...
I used to work at like a call center with kind of helping people in your state are underinsured or not get basic care or get drugs covered. And there was like so many obstacles to get from the appeal process where it was like you had to send a letter by mail to some place in Albany. You know, and if it was the wrong form 2 weeks later, you know, you find out 3 weeks later that all of a sudden your medication's denied. And it's like you talk about going to Mars and like all the things that you know, the technology's there, but sometimes I think at the consumer level, so many barriers to just getting those like basic questions answered or the basic, you know, we have these rights, we have like insurances that are supposed to be protecting us, but sometimes the way that we engage with things that we can get parents like not really accessible, and like it also leads kind of to accountability when we develop these policies, right? But then turn around and like big hospitals or big corporations are like not really following them. How do you basically deal with that as public health leaders? It's about, well, you know, all of these different protecting barriers at the consumer level, what for what you see day to day.
You know, I'm sure you've heard this, the saying, no margin, no mission, right? I actually hate that. I always railed against that because really it's about coming back to mission, right? Because when people say that to me, I say, well, no mission, no margin, right? Because what's the point of having a margin if you can't do something with it? And it's not easy. I'm not saying that there isn't a wave of corporatization of healthcare and hospitals. There really are. There is. You're absolutely right about that. But you know, there you can continually try to remind people in healthcare about the reason they went into healthcare. I mean, that's why the appeal to your staff is so important, right? Because everyone who goes into healthcare went in to make a difference in somebody's life, right? Everyone who goes into that. And even the CEO with the most, whatever, you know, the most blinders on, you can really appeal to that at some point, because it's all the people who work underneath that CEO that is going to be pushing it. Once you remind people about what you're in it for, it actually can happen, believe it or not. We could probably have a long conversation about examples of how it can be done, because when you look at it from 30,000 feet and people are cutting jobs and, you know, they're barring their ERs from people who are uninsured. I'm going to get into trouble if I go into it. But in the public hospital system, we used to, you know, really suffer because everybody would dump on non-paying patients on the public hospitals, right? But it was our mission, so we welcomed them. And then we fought everybody who was dumping whenever we could, right? Because we had to keep reminding people, hey, these are people you have to take care of, and not just because of the dollar signs in front of them, right?
Probably to your point too, as you know, that you can stop or help that way upstream before they come to the emergency room, and that's a choice that systems make.
I think we should just acknowledge that, like, it just sucks. Like, to pretend that any of us up here or anyone in this room has a solve of, like, oh yeah, you just do this, and then suddenly health insurances want to do their middleman job, which is really just to not do the thing because then they don't want to pay, right? I think you have to have all the things in place. It's actually, in my brain, it's three levels. It's one, have a vision of a world in which I don't need someone to tell me as the clinician and the patient what we should do. Mind your business. We're just gonna take care of each other. And like, we don't need, and I think we have to remember that the entire paradigm that we have right now is people have grandmas older than this health insurance system. We started it in the 30s, calm down. Like, it isn't the only way to do it. And we have other nations in the quote unquote global north and global south to look at, to say that other realms of possibility exist. So that's the visionary, work towards that, build policy in that. There's also what I do when I work in the emergency department, which is I'm not actually trying to make a system work for my patients. I'm trying to get my patient through a system that isn't designed to work for them at all. I'm fighting the system every shift. I can't burn it down on shift because I need the things. I need the equipment to help serve, right? So it is heartrending. It is, you're frankly just pissed off, right? Like you have to learn the loopholes, the way to navigate so that you can fight for people. And then there's the middle of how do you take that knowledge to build policies that will help us survive in the meantime as we're working towards communal abundance? Because we have to be pragmatists, right? Like I want to burn it all down, yes, but I also still want to go to K-Town and get great food, right? So like you can't burn it all down at once. We have to survive today so that we can be good ancestors.
You manage in your writing and as you're speaking to both acknowledge, quote unquote, that it sucks, but also you have a vision and you inspire hope. And I think, you know, each one of you in different ways has, Michael Dowling at Northwell always says, nobody follows a pessimist. And, you know, and he says, you know, we're in the business of hope because that's what science is. And that's what public health is. That's what healthcare is. And it's true. And so I really applaud all three of you and thank you very, very much for that hope and for it really gives me a lot of hope to be in this room. And this is really, really exciting to meet you and to engage with you. So thank you all so much.
So I just want to give one final thanks to Margaret, Makini, Ben, and Brian for sharing that wonderful panel and for providing so many wonderful gems and nuggets of wisdom on public health leadership. I agree with you, Brian. Mailman is known for producing great leaders, and it doesn't matter what our title is, what our position is. Everyone has the ability to lead and to do great things. So thank you for that wonderful reminder. We've reached that portion of the agenda where you get to take a break. All right, can I get an amen? All right. So we'll now have a 15-minute break before